This program is brought to you by the Zach Ross Foundation, a philanthropic organization with a focus on poverty, education, mental health, human rights, and cultural exchange. Hosted at the Brennan School of Business at Dominican University, we present to you a lecture series on international management. We hope you enjoy.
Fantastic. How was yours?
Not bad, not bad. I went sailing on
Saturday.
No, 27th, but at Montreal Harbor.
You got a sailboat?
Yeah.
You're going to invite us out before you go to what?
What's that?
You're going to invite us out before you go to what?
I hear that all the time. Like, everybody I know is like, hey, man.
License captain, let's go.
Whatever?
Yeah.
Alright. They gotta be up by October 1st, so we don't have that much.
Let's do it.
See if I can squeeze it. Anything else? Anything exciting? Alright, well, what's the Kanye song or whatever? Like we always do at this time.
Yep.
Yeah, we're going to get into groups. No, do groups of four, and then one group of half five. And talk a little bit about human rights.
I try to jump over.
Did anybody pre-order the iPhone? Yeah, I did. Oh, what size?
What size?
128. I got the 256 and it said November, like middle of November. And jet black. So I think that's a good opportunity to maybe try to see if you can get a job in whatever line of work you're trying to get into.
What is your company hiring?
Actually, we have enough people, staff.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. but no, absolutely. I mean, I have all of you guys' information if I need anything. I'd definitely reach out to you guys. I'd probably reach out to you first before. guys are smarter than a lot of the people I know.
Students get pulled over the other day without any reason.
registration, insurance, et cetera. And so I heard that Professor Cook, one of the black professor, mm-hmm. experienced the same thing riding his bike or walking or something like that. So my question is, have anybody else been pulled over in the course? You didn't feel like any sort of discrimination.
I kind of felt a little uncomfortable because it was so late. I wasn't really doing anything wrong.
Yeah. Yeah, and I just find it to be weird. I know a couple of people when I was a student too, they had pulled over because they don't know where most of the people that live in this. But if you have any other issues like that, let me know. I'll take it to Dean Kersey, he'll take it to the president. And we can go talk to the village manager. Hey, you gotta stop harassing me without a reason. Was it relevant to human rights, right? Was your mention what we're talking about? Who graduates in 2017 here?
Yeah.
respect to 50, like in Louisiana, it used to be 14. I don't know if it is now. I think it may be 16. No, no, it's 18, right? So you guys say, even here in the United States, how complex this perception of youth, age, things like that. So with child labor, what do you consider to be too bad?
Below
15. So 15 years old. You guys feel different. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Isn't it like permits like if you're 13 or 14 and you move into Chicago like a working permit? I mean it's like from the circumstances, but even that's available. I don't know.
Yeah, no, in Europe now, most countries in Europe you can train at was it 16? 16?
I think it's 17.
17. Yeah, you're
yeah.
But it's just something to think about to say, like, hey, you know, this is totally different cultural environment. They don't see things the way we see things. And somebody have a question?
Mm-hmm. I was going to say that they're saying that in certain places like India, child labor is actually seen as good. Like, the kids don't call off their families by working at a young age. They pretty much support their families. If they're working at as young as 80 or 90 years old, in some circumstances, just, you know, in some cultures, that's not necessarily seen as like slave labor or not exactly just a normal part of culture.
It could be seen as being responsible or disciplined or developing characteristics that will make it a better adult.
You don't have, like, countries have kind of responsibility to develop countries that aren't as developed themselves. So I'm working for service companies that allow child labor that is regulated and they provide educational opportunities to students or whatever they do. Or development of the country as a whole.
That's, I mean, that's true, but the thing to consider, so this class focuses on, hey, you're a manager, CEO in the United States, and you're dealing with people across the border. And across the border may not be the United States, North America, and Europe, which is considered the Western thought perception, right? So everything outside of that is something completely different from God's tradition. So do we say, are we encroaching a Western, democratic perspective on people's cultures, trying to make them be what we think is the right thing. And that's what I'm saying, it's a complex thing. There is no universal answer to this. But this is just a thing that's kind of see the different perspectives going on. What else?
We talked about ideas to deal with the problems, and we talked about inclusive businesses, ethical decision-making, and sustainable businesses. So when we say inclusive businesses, kind of going off with what Maddie was saying, that kind of having them do something within the community that they're working with, so giving children education if they're going to actually participate in child labor. And then the role of the corporate Code of Conduct has said that it should pretty much keep them on track of whatever their mission is and what their goal is, and it should help hold them accountable for what their decisions are.
Okay. So it really just depends on companies' Code of Conduct and how they want to do this and some of what they choose to do. Okay.
We had said about the human rights that corporations are responsible to adapt to each different country because no country is the same, so no person is the same. So just know it's acceptable there, like in Haiti, it's not really acceptable there. That's the only way, and that's the only outcome that like, income you might have. So taking that away from them, like, directing people to other ways, need to give money, which is not as good as actually working. We're saying just adapt to like each different country. And I think that's your responsibility to know what your country wants and what you accept.
So with that point, you're saying child labor, you shouldn't get as a company, right? Because that's a system in place there, and that system exists for a reason.
Yeah.
That's what it does. It's going to be there, right? So the system exists maybe because people are economically poor, issues with child abuse. Therefore, these kids are homeless. What can they do? Just play all day or no? They need to find a way to actually live. So most of these kids around the world, in developing countries, they're homeless. Or they're not taking care of themselves, they don't take care of themselves.
Yeah, then you just come in and say, oh, no more child labor laws. You're getting rid of all these jobs for these kids and like, what to do, what to do. They said that you're playing one day, especially with the college.
So not doing that has more of a negative impact than a positive.
Yeah, exactly. And then for human rights concerns, I'd say we talked about child labor, unfavorable conditions, low wages. Then I think the idea is assuming aware of the problem part is the first step towards the change to be responsible for corporations, assuming aware there is a problem. And it's the role that the company has seems socially responsible and being accountable for the employees in that country. And really missing any of the way break the law in that country, the company should be able to be accountable for not probably keeping that employee.
So your code of conduct is written in corporate policy. We adapt to other people's cultures. We work with them. We don't pressure them to take on their ideologies and beliefs. But with that being said, maybe there's some things we don't go beyond. We draw a line on certain issues. Just say, you know, safe working conditions, a fair wage, development, or whatever is cost of living.
I had the same problems we've seen, child labor, inadequate pay, long hours, dangerous working conditions. As far as how multinational corporations should deal with it, we're kind of foreign in some cases, so as far as like child labor, my first idea was to, you know, try to deal with those things, but sometimes you don't want to, you know, interfere with other cultures by, like you said, imposing your Western philosophy on them. Mm-hmm. So I guess what we would do is, you know, kind of, yeah, you know, child labor is a hard issue. As far as the other issues that you had with pay and long hours and everything, you're saying multinational corporations could offer their foreign workers the same types of benefits and pay as they do their local workers. And they, since they have a huge, you know, presence and power to all their money, so they would try to lobby for change a little more successfully than normal people could. So, you know, try to get into like a political system and form up here to inspire change.
So similar to them, adapt, all the stuff that happens. Safe working conditions, and then go in from the top. So funnel money in from the top to lobby so that the government changes the systems and the structures of what's in place.
These are good like ideas, but don't really have to happen, right? Because they go overseas to cut costs instead of keeping costs out of it. Is that right?
Well, I mean, that's the nature of what we define ethics, define morals.
I mean, define if they want to get these like child laborers higher wages, why would they say, you know, America?
Well, I mean, higher wages for them is significantly still lower than 10, 12, 15, 20, $25 an hour. I mean, we're still talking relative to the dollar, we're talking 80 cents an hour, $1.25. So it's still going to always be, and that might be like, hey, I could pay $1.25 an hour. This is awesome. I make the most of my neighborhood. So you're still being good on that end. But the point is, you have to set what is it you're all about as a company. Are you actually about doing good stuff and making money? Or are you all about money? Because if it's all about money, you have to think, well, what's the corporate culture back home in the States? It's all about money, then, you know, nobody. I care about you, you know, you're just a unit, you're fired, you don't do your job, you're not paying your money, and that's it. And then that translates over to the other country,
We could absolutely care less about them because they're not even here. You probably give them an adequate spread as a part of smaller, that's kind of big, et cetera, et cetera. So the point is, we have to create to say, hey, what is our policy? Where do we have an ethics code of conduct? Do we have a moral code? What is the definition of these things? And from there, you can say, hey, you know what? We do. And we can make a lot more money if we start doing good things and market those good things so that people can see and say, I want to be affiliated with that company and look it up and say, stuff it. Not just like, hey, we're the best finance company in the world. You got to do all this stuff too. You know, so. But it's complex, you know, because many successful companies don't have ethical protocols, especially the international companies. Particularly, you know, in manufacturing, so most of the clothes are wearing tags, no manual tags, etc. And now it's starting to get to my turn. But you can see how this stuff changed if you're reading it. You can see how we talk a lot more about Turkey because we're doing way more business with them. Now you're closer to the name of Turkey instead of China. Right? China's moving away, people want more money there, better conditions, all the spotlight is there. No, let's go over the spotlight's not. But that's the thing. You know, define ethics, define morals, and it probably changes from everybody. You know, religious beliefs, family, et cetera. That's everybody there. What's next? What else do you have? Oh, here we go.
Well, Mark, you have talked about goals. We put like awareness, we were aware of the things that are going on. We also said not to make it worse and not to make it worse. And we also said
you're aware. Mm-hmm. Like, hey, you know, we run all the data here. This is about the average cost of living. This is what people normally get paid to do a specific job. We see what's going on politically, socially. We know it. It's happening. So you're saying just be aware, but maybe not act on it. Just know it exists. Maybe turn on the TV or something.
Yeah.
Well,
some of the tips to use their power.
Through what use of like the government, or like advertising, or start a program, or whatever?
Well, yeah, that's kind of what we said about the
government. Okay. For social program.
Yeah. But some of the concerns just say everyone else can have a child labor, for child punishment, and their leaders. Going along with the solution then, we kind of said, we would try and trust what we see. And then we also said developing social programs and to practice what we teach.
Nice, so that's me. Like I said, guys, I mean, this is a very complex issue that companies have. Trying to identify ethics, morals, put it into a corporate policy that follows what everyone can follow. When you start a multinational corporation, you just proceed to take it out of it. So you play ball halfway. You know, you work with people, you also get dragged. And if there's nothing illegal, whatever it is you're doing, it's not out of the legal realm. So the point of this is human rights. Is there a such thing as human rights? Yes?
By the UN?
Same thing. According to the United Nations, perhaps, is everyone familiar with the United Nations?
Yes.
So over 200 countries, United Nations, everybody votes, comes to a consensus, and adopt and enact procedures and agreements,
set up ways to do that. Fundamental freedoms. What do you think human beings should have as freedom? Universal. Anybody?
Wall.
For basic nutrition, water and food, people shouldn't just be allowed to die, right? Because they can't access water and food. And that's probably the most basic. Nothing else matters. What are they? Education? So freedom to learn. We don't want people to be restricted to say, like, hey, you can't learn that. It's against the law. You can't read that book. You can't read that book. You can't access that. Safety. So safe in our homes, safe in the streets, safe in what regards?
Like they shouldn't be set up by the children and die.
Yeah. So bodily harm, huh?
Yeah, but I mean, it also kind of brings into that, like, work and use type.
So you have a right to own your body.
Yeah.
And also you're saying in the right
way. Yes, in mind is patient. Like people should feel like further use other people and take advantage of people.
So physical and emotional abuse. You shouldn't be allowed to harass people, right? And it's here in the United States, you're allowed to be harassed by the police. What else? Any other rights? What rights do we have here in the United States? It's fundamental rights, constitutional rights. If you live in a country, you should be able to participate in what the government does in it. You're a citizen, you're born in it. Regardless of you pay taxes or not, you're still a citizen. Speak. Speech is so awesome, also goes to expression. Yeah. Because speech is communication. You have the right to communicate. You should be in society. But then we say, hey, you know, the company has its own policy. So it goes above the government. The government allows it to do it. So then you say, hey, the NFL is a company. Should Colin Kaepernick be allowed to do that if you are the owner of the San Francisco 49ers? What did you say about Colin Kaepernick? Yeah. What did you say about Colin Kaepernick? That you own the team. And you pay him $30 million a year.
I think you might, if you worry about the image of your team amongst the United States people here, it might cause an outrage. But then, when you kind of look back to your athletes, you know, you believe in, I'd be all for whatever you want to expect. You need media, anything else you're going to do without.
Okay. And you say, hey, you know what, I'm all for a common character, and he has, yeah, the right to express himself. And he sees injustices in society, and this is his way to help us in injustices. And then, say, you hear San Francisco Police Department. He gathers all their family members for the fire department. That's the guy that's in the military, you know, etc. And they're like, hey, you know, we're not going to gang anymore. Now it's fading us out. You as a manager, I mean, you as the owner, you just lost 200. What do you do about common character?
I guess I'm doing something new, so,
yeah. Yeah. Like, so take it as a lost cause, yeah. But you keep them on the team, because you don't want to be persuaded by how the news and media and society is saying. How we should operate in this country.
Yeah. I mean, if I shut them down, or if I take off the team, it's just showing that we're not really allowing someone to be able to express themselves and have me expose them like that.
Okay. So you throw them in the locker room, let them come out after the match, and that's what you would do?
Yeah, just throw them in and come out.
So you would restrict them. I mean, obviously that would make a media frenzy too. Like, yeah, hey, why Colin Kaepernick stay in the locker room during the national anthem while the owner said that you're not allowed to come out?
You're paying him $30 million a year. I mean, you'd have to find a say in it, so that's what I would do.
So you would override his...
I'm paying him to play on my exam, so yes, I'm going to control him. Yeah.
And this is what makes it interesting. Everybody has a different perspective. Any other writers?
That's the posture game.
Everybody should be treated equally under the law, right? I'm worth $150 million, you would be unemployed, so that would be treated differently. Like a problem that's sentence right now. And that's probably one of the good response to the one more problem. So yeah, I mean another my thought is, you know, as a company, you should, my thing is life is always moving, right? Everything's in the middle, everything's moving. But you should always try to be somewhere in the middle as a company. Company cannot totally reflect your religious beliefs, custom to the tradition. It has to reflect kind of a conscious awareness about what else has been going on in this market, in this industry, in the macroeconomics of this country. Because you still have a fiduciary duty to people involved within the company. You have people who are stakeholders, or stockholders, or shareholders. You have a responsibility towards your employees. You have a responsibility towards maybe the CEO, just like the regular manager, general manager. So I think you should, I like the approach of adaptation. You know, you go in there, you do this, this house is done there. And then you can come back on top, implementing programs, social programs, marketing plans, working with the governments to make things better, or to just begin the conversation, like, hey, you know, can life be better here in this country? Because what's been going on, like, the way that people actually want to live, or just because they're restricted to by people? Most of the time, you find that it's not how people want to live. It's basically how they have in mind. And also, in every country, is. Yeah, the United States has a high middle class, and we'll talk about that. It's a very large, large middle class. People at the top pay the least amount of taxes relative to income. And people in between, which is the majority of Americans, pay all the taxes for all the work. And then the people at the bottom, you know, and the government assistance, or just barely making it. But most other countries around the world have very small middle class. So it's either you're rich or you're poor. It's just very black and white. So then you ask the question, like, well, for the majority of people in here are poor, should we not raise the wage? Should we not give them the best working conditions? Should we not give them the best this and that? Because maybe through globalization, we'll see how great work we're doing, and they'll start doing it too. And then you make real change. You know, you set a precedent so that people can follow you, follow your footsteps, and in turn, you make more revenue off of that in the long run. You know, so you take this short-term loss and saying, hey, you know, I'm going to give these people good pay, we give them awesome working conditions, and they're going to provide employee housing. For the sake of our long-term objectives, and hey, you know, this country is fertile, this guy, I believe it's going to change in 20 years, and we're going to be the leaders, we're going to be the forefront of this change. So we'll look at some of the benefits and costs. So let's ask ourselves, what is the benefit of starting another company in a foreign land, somewhere else in Australia? What is the corporate benefit to us here in the United States? You know, we have our headquarters here. How would it benefit? What are some of the benefits?
You need to mark who you know you would have access to.
You broaden your market. You're allowing opportunities to make more money and grow. What else? From a pure business or a financial perspective, what is a financial or economic benefit to starting a new, you know, a subsidiary or a smaller company?
Yeah,
cheaper cost and you can pay lower wages.
Cell phones, Brent?
Most of them are not made here.
They're designed here.
You don't have to pay local tax, the corporate tax.
Yeah.
Lower taxes. Little to no taxes versus an exorbitant amount of taxes in the United States. Saying, hey, I make the same product elsewhere. How much more money are we going to make just due to taxes? 25% versus 1% is relative to this, about foreign exchange. You say, okay, the strongest value of dollars in the world is the British pound, the EU's euro, and the dollar. But if you go to a place where the dollar is valued at $1,000, that's a lot of money. Remember, Tanzania is one of the poorest countries in the world. It was always in like the bottom three. But at one time, their inflation rate, it was like in billions. To literally like a loaf of bread, they had started printing out like $1 million bills. You would go buy a loaf of bread on the good hand of somebody like $1 million for a loaf of bread. Yeah. So essentially, if you are a company, you're like, well, maybe Tanzania, you do an assessment and say, hey, maybe there's some opportunities for here in Tanzania. By the way, we probably can buy the whole country if we wanted to. You know what I mean? So you have to consider those things. Like, hey, you know what? We have so much money, and the inflation rate is so ridiculous that we can buy an entire city, we can buy a town, we can buy a state. We could eliminate any competitors right now to jump on it, as opposed to like, if the company, if the country's fertile and the job is going to be 10 to 12 years. Costs. What are some of the costs? Instead, look on the opposite of them. What's some of the risks and the costs associated with doing business?
The headquarters is probably.
Your headquarters,
your local headquarters.
Okay, right. So you could, so you're creating a gap. Creating gaps in company, right? Maybe a cultural gap. Maybe this subsidiary is completely different than who we are here. Yeah. You don't like it. We want to change things. Maybe it's just too far. Maybe there's the language barriers. You're just creating gaps all over the place. What else?
Maybe the supply chain.
Yeah,
maybe the supply chain is too complex.
Whereas before, you took three steps to get your products or whatever your services to the end consumer, and that takes 100. Look at the cell phone company. Some of those cell phones they probably work with maybe 50 different countries with 50 different parts until you go up to the finished product, right? So the processor from Germany, you get the transistor from Taiwan, you get the screen from Korea. You can say, well, how long is it going to take that? now we're not able to be an early dropper and get it off the market. Now we gotta wait. Now I gotta wait till middle of November to get the iPhone 7 Plus Jet Black 256 gigabytes. Yeah. Wow. That's a very complex supply chain, you know? When you have to create a product like that in X amount of time. What about employment? What are some of the benefits and costs in regards to employment with doing business overseas? What are the benefits?
You might be able to find workers that have more skills to explore.
Better skill there.
High volumes of new workers, might have the type of special education that you want.
Yeah,
you
hire 10,000 people in India as opposed to just hiring 20 here in the United States. And that is
you might be giving people in other countries opportunities to work that they wouldn't have had otherwise.
Yeah. The direct creation of new jobs. It'll be the first time someone's ever worked in their life, you know, where you essentially first person to create a position, you know, as opposed to be able to get a same position to start. Well, any cost to it associated with this?
So again, like, are you able to train all these workers?
You may literally have to teach them English, right? So they can call back to the United States and speak to me and say, well, how much can it cost to train 10,000 people to speak English? And how long is it going to take, and how effective it works? And what would be better to do if you wrote it?
Also, more about the impact of reaching your own parent staff and how to deal with their culture and how to manage them.
This would be very expensive to do. Anything else. What about competition? Example being China. What if that's already a disaster? Yeah. Going to China to get cheap labor.
It's just too many competitors. It's just too many, too much competition. And at other places might have scarcity for those particular skills outside of China. So China is too competitive. The rest of the world don't have the skills to do this and too possible. So just really very hard. This is something really kind of outside of the textbook, but I think it's a good thing to learn as a manager having operations overseas to evaluate or assess, is it worth doing business overseas? That's called a real world evaluation. Real-world evaluation deals primarily with looking at the constraints within a country, such as time, budget, data. You can't get any data. You're doing operations. You want to do operations, you can't see them, but you can't even get anything on that. So the alternative approach would be the utilization approach, which is essentially saying, hey, I have a good feeling, I have an intuitive feeling that Tanzania is fertile ground. I think there's great opportunities here, but we have very little mathematical metrics to go on. This is the opportunity. This is also with complete metrics and constraints. First thing you want to do is planning and scoping. This is essentially what a real CEO will do. So if you're a CEO, you're looking at, hey, you know, I have a great idea, let's go over to South Africa. It's a great opportunity to do that sort of thing. How are we going to approach this? Well, we have to get all this information about South Africa. The first thing we want to do is a use assessment. What is South Africa? What we got? Maybe what our office is not really good. That's what we'll do. Second is identifying time, budget, and data constraints. As a CEO, you would look to say, once again, there's a great opportunity, I think, here. I have a gut feeling that we can go here and implement this product or this service. But we only have a limited amount of time to do it. We can only allocate a certain amount of money in order to see if it can be done. And the only data we can get is to go through the government. There's really no corporate or economic or market companies in its locations so that we could reference that. That's step two. This deals directly with addressing the budget constraints. Thank you. see what we might do.
You're going to look for reliable data. The first thing you will come up with is there was the government data, the census. Another option will be, hey, let's put people on the ground. Let's go out with questionnaires and surveys and see if y'all know what kind of needs they do. How people do it, what's the demographic, what's the population of the Asian population, what's the income levels. It's a good one. Third is time constraints. We'll finish this up on Thursday, but we'll get back more into exactly how we're going to, as a CEO, you're going to look to foreign environments to say how exactly do I help my good business and be successful.
Okay.
You know, and do the same for marketing. Say, well, you know,
this retail stuff, when we're ready to market. Because, I mean, when you get out and have a startup on, it's going to be a big entry-level position, right? But it's going to be probably more marketing than the one we're working with. Which is kind of what we're doing. So you just want to show the leadership.
Okay.
I would recommend.
And do you have any like positions that you would recommend like research or into like career paths?
Because if you want to travel,
yeah.
You want to do project management for years.
Something.
I would say okay. I would say then maybe you want to go to NGO or there's a lot of these organizations. And there's a lot of small ones that you could probably get more notoriety, you know, graduates and things like that. So I would mainly focus on non-government organizations with international work.
Yeah.
Do a little research to see, like, what exactly kind of skills are they looking for in these positions to work overseas? And then cater my resume specifically to that. So the various culture, I've been able to see several times, I know how to effectively communicate all walks of life, blah, 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 talk about hiring, talk about everything else.
Okay, so I got to do that, talk about charity work, right?
Absolutely, right. Yeah. So if you're going to do that, and really get into the international, this is where I've been, time frames, and how effective I've communicated with these people, and go with some nice skills that I have. I think one page is enough. Some people do two pages, but I think things could be edited out to one page. I just find that anything more than one page. It's just it's not you or me or anybody, it's just really just the hiring managers. They just don't like it. Yeah, now it's the time to do it. For each one of these three that you could create, we may need to do a tagline. A tagline would be like experience international leader.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, like,
identify.
Yeah, identify, right? So,
like, give myself kind of a label.
Give yourself a label. It's just certain things that may stick out. Like, okay, people would do this. So you can know this and say, go on Facebook, go on LinkedIn, go on Instagram. Now they have taglines for everything, right? You write something under your name, philosopher, humanitarian, blah, blah, blah. That, to me, is a shift I see in people getting hired to separate themselves from others.
So it's like branding yourself.
Kind of branding yourself. But I would do that last to say, make it general. You know, so follow every kind of name that is following yourself. And yeah, I mean, that's pretty much it. Education at the bottom, experience at the top. Do three that you think you want to go in. And it could just be one for strictly management, one strictly for marketing, and the third strictly for But I mean, as far as that, you've done everything very good. So I really like the summary. You pretty much hit all the major points and things like that you've done. One of the other things is maybe eliminate one from each and add a measure. So then you can just do one from each place that you work. I mean, I see it here. Yeah, I see it.
We go here. I think if your business went under, I mean, why do you have the world's smallest customer?
Exactly.
That's the problem.
I would just make it one
minute.
Okay. That was a very cash flow.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, everything else is great, but I would say throw in one place.
Okay.
I like a number for each one. Increase sales, increase, you know, projected earnings, and you can think of, and then you actually get, you just have to know. Quarterly sales and fall, or the training, some sports. So yeah, I'd say three, and then that one, you can find a job, yeah, yeah. My three resumes, one of them I'm gonna go over here, put that in on this one, and then something else.
Okay.
But I think number one is really probably tailored to say first, what are we doing? So look around and be like, ooh, this is a cool job. You know, like, this place, Amnesty International, they have this job, and you can have a job, and bam, there's your third resume going out to that. And you're like, all right, I'm not gonna wait around here for now. I select like 10 from each. Not 10 from each, but maybe 10 all together, the different ones that I really want to do. And similar parts. So if you want to see my digital marketing secondary, you just can't go around marketing. So marketing management also goes hand in hand. Yeah, and that's it. And just cross, you know, cross the track. And then I get something else as well. Yeah, and I mean, you know, if you finish them, and then you want to look back at them.
Yeah.
Okay. And then also, I'll send you the information with the career development.
Yeah, I didn't think that. So
yeah,
I just did. Career development, I'm going to get it.
Okay. I'll send you an email that's sent me. There's like, oh, you know, we two new guys on the roster and they're exactly those, and you know, it's not something that we're interested in, have some others. But I'll send you their information, and mother maybe you can go talk to them too.
I was graduating my bachelor's, I mean, I'm still lost. I don't know what I want to do.
good though? I mean, at least you're competing students. Well, already doing, you know, like, by the time they graduate, you've already got your name out there. You want something to have an internship and kind of defensive points. Because, you know, everybody's graduating in May, that's a lot of competition.
I know, it's not happening a lot of stuff, but it just makes kind of stressful right now.
Yeah.
But if you care about any competition.
Presentation was brought to you by the Zach Ross Foundation, a global philanthropic organization focusing on poverty, education, and mental health. We hope you've enjoyed.